Baseball has been known as America's greatest pastime, and that was never more true than in the 1930s and 40s when the game helped raise the spirits of a nation bested by the Great Depression and World War II. That was true here in Washington County as well. Three of our greatest players came of age during the Depression, and their lives were each affected by World War II. In this episode of History Revealed, we'll look at their lives and their stories. Well, Ken, we're here at Valley Memorial Park in Hillsborough to talk about Wes Schulmerich. That's not a household name to many baseball fans.
Not today, it's not. But 90 years ago, he was perhaps one of the most famous athletes in Oregon, but not for baseball, because baseball wasn't even his best sport. He was so good at football that the legendary Notre Dame coach, Newt Rockne, heavily recruited him to go to Notre Dame. But he decided to stay a little closer to home, and he went to Oregon Agricultural College, which today is Oregon State University, where he became a huge football star.
Did he ever play professional football?
No. He probably could have, although he didn't get recruited heavily. But even though football was maybe his best game, his heart was in baseball. And so rather than playing professional football, he decided instead that he would play amateur baseball. He played in like the mining league in Montana, for example, for free, just to try to get the notice of a scout so that he could, someday maybe play professional baseball.
And which team was that?
Well, it was in 1930, and it was the Chicago Cubs who signed him. But before he ever played a game for them, he was traded to the Boston Braves. And he played very well for the Boston Braves for the first few years until 1933, when the Braves traded him to the Philadelphia Phillies. And they probably were sorry they did, because after the trade, he really caught fire and he ended up finishing fifth in the league in batting average.
And how long did he stay in baseball?
Well, 1933 was probably the highlight of his major league career, but he'd stayed in the majors for a few years and then went to the minor leagues and continued to have a pretty good career. Might have kept playing, except in 1941, after the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, he quit baseball to join the Navy. And he went on to have quite a distinguished naval career, too. Ended up being a lieutenant commander in the Navy by war's end, at which point, by the time the war was over, his career was over, too. So he came back to Oregon, and he settled over in Tillamook County, where he became a Tillamook County commissioner for many, many years, and also became known as OSU's super fan, basically. It's said that he never missed an OSU Beavers football game for many decades. He was in the first crop of inductees into the Oregon State University Athletic Hall of Fame, and he's also in the Oregon State Athletic Hall of Fame.
Would you say that Wes was Washington County's greatest player?
Perhaps, but I think the fellow we're going to talk about next probably holds that honor.
What can you tell us about Larry Jansen?
Well, as you can see, we're in farm country here in Verbort, prime farm country, and the Jansen family has farmed land around here for generations. And Larry was no exception to that. He grew up on the farm pitching hay, and I think that all that pitching hay led to a natural career. Strong arm, he became one of the primary pitching prospects in all of baseball. And by 1941, he was ready to be a star.
Aha, there's that year again, 1941. Did he go into the military after Pearl Harbor?
No, he didn't, as a matter of fact. Because there, when there's a war effort going on, of course you need people in the military, but you also need to feed both the people back home and the guys out there on the war effort. So the military actually gave him a farming exemption. to stay home here in Vrbord. But you can see the problem here, because when do you farm? Summer.
Right.
When do you play baseball? Summer. So he couldn't do both. So he ended up losing several of the prime years of his career back here on the farm, unable to play baseball.
Did that hurt him as a player?
We'll never know, but he never skipped a beat when he did get back. By 1947, he did get called up to the New York Giants, and he went 21-5, which is just an astonishing record. Almost any other year, he would have been the easy Rookie of the Year winner. The only problem was that same year, a fellow by the name of Jackie Robinson broke in. So he ended up finishing second in the Rookie of the Year balloting.
Was that the highlight of his career?
Certainly was one of them. But probably the highlight came a few years later in 1951, when he was involved again in one of the most famous games in history that happened to involve Jackie Robinson.
Oh, really?
Yes, he was the Dodgers that year with Jackie Robinson, got off to just a fantastic start, and it looked like they were gonna run away with the pennant. But Larry Jansen's Giants came out of nowhere. So they ended up in a tie at the end of the season.
Wow.
And they played, they had a one-game playoff that year to see who would go to the World Series. And Larry Jansen, by the way, had just a phenomenal year. He won 23 games that year. So they had the one-game playoff, and it was the Dodgers and the Giants, which would have been a big deal anyways. But it turns out that it became one of the most famous games in playoff history because they stayed tied until extra innings.
Wow.
And then a fellow by the name of Bobby Thompson hit a home run, a walk-off game-winning home run that became known as the shot heard round the world.
Right.
And it's, you know, one of the classic baseball games of all time. And guess who the winning pitcher was?
Larry Jansen. Wow, that was quite a career.
It wasn't over yet. He went on to pitch for a few more years, but then he stayed in baseball, and it today is almost as well known for his career as a pitching coach as for his actual days of pitching. He was the Giants coach after they moved to San Francisco for many years, and among the players that he taught were Hall of Famers like Juan Marichal and Gaylord Perry, and he wrote a book, basically. He wrote Sporting News did a book about how to play baseball, and for the part about how to pitch, they chose Larry Jansen, because he really was sort of one of the first real professional coaches.
Hmm.
But you know, through all that, throughout his career, as fabulous and as long as it was, he never once lost focus on Vrbord and his family. He was just fiercely devoted to his family, so much so that even on the backs of his baseball cards, some of the highlights he wanted featured were his love of his family. So he was quite a guy.
Wow, that's interesting. Well, I know we have one other person to talk about today. Who could possibly top Larry Jansen?
I'm not sure anybody could top him, but the next guy we're going to talk about has quite an amazing story of his own.
So we're here at the grave of Harvey Story. Tell us, Ken, how did World War II affect Harvey's career?
Well, Harvey was an up-and-coming star in the Pacific Coast League, mostly for the San Francisco Seals at the time. And he was such a big star that at the time, he was often considered to be the heir apparent to Joe DiMaggio,
wow,
who had just gone up to the Yankees from the Seals and, you know, probably the greatest player of his generation, perhaps. Harvey Story was seen as being just as good as Joe DiMaggio. And in fact, many people thought that Harvey Story would completely revolutionize the position of shortstop.
Really? How so?
Well, at the time, and even now, most shortstops tend to be smaller. They're known more for their speed and agility.
Sure.
But Harvey was not. Harvey was a great big guy. He was very strong. He hit for tremendous home run power. So many people thought that he'd be the first home run hitting shortstop. And he was in the minor leagues. And just as he got called up, though, he was signed by the Chicago Cubs to go up to the major leagues. And two things happened. First, he hurt his leg. And then Pearl Harbor happened. And so Harvey really wanted to see combat. So he joined the Navy.
And did he see combat?
No. No, not unless you think of playing baseball in Pasco, Washington as combat. But Harvey's problem, if you will, was that he was such a good ball player that instead of sending him off on a ship or something somewhere, they sent him, the Navy sent him to be part of their elite touring baseball team.
Interesting.
That would go from base to base to keep the morale up of the other sailors. So, you know, he played baseball all through the war and kept his skills sharp and everything. But by the time the war was over, he just was no longer seen as a prospect. And so he didn't retire. In fact, he went on to play many, many more years, mostly in the Pacific Coast League. Big star with the Portland Beavers, for example. He played in San Diego. He played in Milwaukee. He managed in the minor leagues for a time.
Wow.
He was a huge star in the minor leagues, but he never got the opportunity to play in the major leagues. And the irony is that not long after he was out of baseball, baseball got its power hitting shortstop. Ernie Banks came along for the Cubs, of all places, and became that power hitting shortstop. He was followed by the likes of Cal Ripken Jr., Alex Rodriguez. Today, it's not that uncommon to have a power hitting shortstop, but unfortunately, Harvey, as storied as his career was, if you will, never got to be the first of the power hitting shortstops.
Very interesting. We talked about three men who helped put Washington County on the baseball map, if only for a short time. I'm Cindy Dower. Join us for more amazing stories from Washington County in the next episode of History Revealed.